inhabitants of God to his people. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of bondage. You shall have no other gods but me.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
You shall not make for yourself any idol.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
You shall not invoke with malice the name of the Lord your God.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
Honor your father and your mother.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
You shall not commit murder.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
You shall not commit adultery.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
You shall not steal.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
You shall not be a false witness.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor.
Amen. Lord have mercy.
Praise God, we are God has given us is infinitely greater than those things that are trying to hold us back. Our God is greater, He's stronger, okay? And He's a God that when we come to Him in humility and faith and trust, He will not, will never, ever fail us. Amen? As we come before Him this day, we are grateful. We can come before the Lord's presence, in the Lord's house, in front of the Lord's people, to hear the Lord's word, and then later to partake from the Lord's table. We speak by today, with all the information we're receiving today from technology and social media. We can get so much cluttered with so many things, but really there is one thing that is needful, and according to Jesus, it's that we sit by the Master's feet, listen to what He has to say, and make plans in order to apply them in to our lives. Amen? Let's listen to what God has to say.
The second reading is taken from the second epistle of Paul the Apostle to Corinthians, chapter 5. the reading. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing the trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading to us, we implore you, on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. So to say, Bible, this is the word, Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pause for a moment and find one word so we have a question.
Please stand.
Oh.
So Lord, be with you.
May the Lord open our minds and lips and our hearts to hear his holy gospel. The holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
We read the Saint's Gospel, chapter 15, beginning in verse 11 and in verse 30. Then he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me a portion of the goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with pretty well living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and bring saying to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me one like your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him, and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring in his hand, and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. They began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of his servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and could not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, all these many years I have been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time. And yet, you never gave me a young goat, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this your son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harvest, you killed and fatted calf for him. And he said to me, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad. For your brother was dead, is alive again, and was lost, and is found. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
please keep that in the home.
Praise be to God. Today is Fourth Sunday in Lent. We are once again hearing a very familiar story. But it's not just a story. The things that the Lord is showing us was meant to give us a glimpse of how the kingdom of God works, of who God is, what kind of a God is He. And it shows us how much God loves us. Today we have our theme, walking in the Father's stair. To be able to walk in the Father's stair, that means that we are to trust Him in everything. Even when we feel like we want to compromise something, because if we sometimes feel if we trust God, things will collapse, and things will not go our way. But then that's when faith is faith. When you don't know how things will turn out, it's easy to have faith or to trust in God in the daylight. But praise be to God, it's when we have faith in the night, when it is the darkest of the dark, that we can really have, say that faith is faith. When it seems like nothing is working for us, when it seems like God is absent, when it seems like that He's no longer there. Because we have to have faith that our Father is a God whom we can trust. Amen? We need to understand this, church, and in this particular story, we normally focus on the prodigal son, because that's it has that label here, okay? The parable of the lost son, the prodigal son. Some Bibles it says prodigal. When you talk about prodigal, it means wasteful, lavish living. In other words, it's someone who spends everything without thinking, okay? It's wasting resources, it's wasting everything. If a person is gifted, then he's not using it for the right things, but he's using it for the wrong things. You understand what I'm saying? So when you talk about a prodigal son, it's talking about a son who's not wise concerning the resources, the giftings, the skills, the talents which God had given him. Okay? And so normally when we talk about this particular story, we focus on the prodigal son. But today we would like to shift our focus and look at the Father. Or rather look at the reaction, the attitude of the Father of the prodigal son. Because I believe that through the Father of the prodigal son in this particular story, we are able to see a glimpse of God, our Father. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay? And so today, basically, there's going to be a lesson that the Lord is wanting us to remember. It's basically this. The Father's unlimited grace and unconditional love should give us assurance in this life. The Father's unlimited grace and unconditional love should give us assurance in this life. Okay? Now we need to understand that the grace of God is unlimited. Alright? According to St. Paul, where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. No matter how deadly, how lethal, how bad the world seems to be getting, and really, based on what's going on, the world deserves to be destroyed. So how come it's still functioning? How come it's still not yet destroyed? Because the grace that God has given us is greater than the sin. Do you understand what I'm saying? We need to see that, church. And when we talk about the Father's love is unconditional. There's nothing you can do to make Him love you more. And there's nothing you can do to make Him love you less. He doesn't love you less than He loves Jesus. He doesn't love Jesus more than He loves you. He loves you and me just as He loves the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand what I'm saying? Amen? We need to understand that, church. His unlimited grace, His unconditional love. If we were really going to think about this, If we are really going to make the same sick down in our hearts, then they should fill us with assurance. I used to remember when I was a kid, and you know, I'd go out with my bagada, and I sometimes would make jokes. Did you go to mass last Sunday? It's kind of hard, you know, because some things are done. I was afraid that we would go to mass, then we would be burned. Okay? Somehow, or rather, we would try not to go to church so much, or prayer for us was something that we did not really like to do. We had an apprehension of coming near this God that we're talking about now, because we did not understand. We thought God was a grumpy old man with a club that every time you make a mistake, boom. You understand what I'm saying? All right? That's what we thought God was. And so it really did not inspire us or move us to come to God. The only time that we would really come to God is when we are really, really in deep trouble. Okay? And we come to God and we try to come up with prayers that's, you know, we thought we could manipulate God and get on his feelings and forget all the bad things we've done and somehow give us the help that he's capable of giving. We didn't understand then that this God who created us is the same God who chose to have a father-children relationship with us. Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, he's not just creator and we're creation. I mean, that's the only relationship we can have with our God. That would be fine. But he brought our relationship with him to another level. He said, I am your father. I have adopted you. And you are now members of my family. You know, if we were just creations relating to our creator, then he could say, well, okay, guys, you are citizens of my kingdom. That's it. But we're not just citizens of his kingdom. We are now also members of his family. You understand what I'm saying? How many of you are citizens of the Philippines? Some of you are not sure. You've been here for a long time, still not sure. Okay? Will you just allow anyone to come to your house, into your room, and sleep in your bed? Even if they are citizens of the Philippines? No. They have no intimate relationship with them. Okay? But what if your kids come to your house? Will you allow them to your house? How's this reading the post of Patriarch Bates today? He's in Jacksonville and he'll be preaching at the Church of the Messiah, the church I preached to last year. And he's staying in a hotel. Now, some of his kids who stayed there visited him in his hotel. Okay? And his grandkids were there. So what do? They take over the bedroom, they stay in bed, and he doesn't shoo them away. But rather, he orders ice cream. So that they can eat ice cream in his bed, and so they can watch the movie in his bedroom, in his bed. Why? Because they're family. You understand what I'm saying? You have a higher, deeper, much more intimate level. It's what Jesus Christ taught us. You have a Father in heaven. There is a God in heaven, but I want you to know he's also your Father. He has a father's heart towards you. He's inclined to listen to you. He's inclined to bless you. He's disposed to do favors for you because he loves you. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is the kind of God we have. And we would like to be able to see our Father, especially as we go through this particular pattern. Okay, next. Let's look at certain things here. Okay, three things I'd like to share with you. And just kind of like summarize them so that, from verse verse 11 through verse 16, the first one I'd like to share with you is this. It's foolishness to turn away from our Father. It's foolishness to turn away from our Father. Okay? Second thought I'd like to share with you, basically this is verse 17 to 19. When we realize our mistake, turn away from the Father. Go back. When we realize our mistake, go back. Okay? And then from verse 32. Because of his love, repentance and reconciliation will always be available to us. Because of his love, repentance and reconciliation will always be available to us. Okay, let's look at this then, the story of that. Okay? Getting to verse 11. Then he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. Okay? Take note. This is not in the Middle East. Basically, this is a story where the customs are, you can find that somewhere in the Middle East. This is something that you don't do because you have to honor your parents. In other words, this younger son is saying, Father, I know I have an inheritance of you. And I know that I can only get the inheritance when you die. But the problem is, Father, you seem to be so healthy. Okay? You're strong. You're healthy. You take care of yourself. You don't waste your life. You don't go night after night partying, getting drunk. Okay? You don't waste your resources. You take care of yourself. It seems like you're not going to die for a very, 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 very long time. And by the time I get my inheritance, I might be really too old to kind of enjoy it. So, Father, can you give it to me now? In other words, to us, it might not seem so, but during that particular time, when you do that, you are wishing death on your parents. You understand what I'm saying? I wish you'd die now so I can get my inheritance. Okay? This was a shameful thing. The Catholic, and was this son aware of what he was doing? Probably was. Did he care? He probably did not care. Okay? This was a shameful thing that he was asking. And, you know, if other parents heard about this, one of the things that they would thank God for is this: Lord, I'm thankful my son is not like that guy. You understand what I'm saying? So you would think the father would scold him. You would think the father would call him, you stupid, ungrateful boy. After all I've done for you, after I've raised you up, and I've given you the best, this is how you talk to me, this is how you approach me, this is how you shame me. You would think that he would do that. That's not what he does. It says here, so he divided to them his livelihood. You need to understand something, church. There are some things God our Father does not want us to engage in. Okay? But if we choose to do that, he will send us workers to advise us. He'll probably send his Holy Spirit also night after night, and we become restless. We cannot sleep because our conscience begins to bother us. And probably we might be present in a sermon like this, and he begins to highlight certain parts of the message and talks to you. I'm not doing that thing. You understand what I'm saying? But see, we were created in the image of God. And And just as God would like for us to honor Him, He honors us. He honors our free will. God gave us the choice to walk with Him, to receive Him, or to reject Him. God says, this is the plan, this is the purpose I have for your life. But we have the choice to reject this plan and follow our own plan. God, He says to us, this is the way how I want you to live. But we could reject that and say, no, God lives the way I want to live. Your way is boring. Your way is boring. Your way is not exciting. Your way is not friendly. Your way is not cool. And so I live my way. I'll take it sorry. I did it my way. You understand what I'm saying? God won't stop. Right? I mean, think about when He created Adam and Eve. God said, I made all of these trees three. There's only one tree you should not eat from. Then, did they eat from that tree?
Yeah.
That they were forbidden to take fruit from?
Yes.
Yes, they did, right? I mean, you don't see God. You know, at the moment Eve was going to reach for the apple, you don't suddenly see God come swooping in and snatch away her hand. And, did I get enough of that apple? You don't see God doing that. Did God know? She was going through what He was going. She was going to do that. Oh yeah, God is God. He knew what Eve was about to do, and He knew what Adam was also going to do out of that. And He was watching. And He was probably hoping, don't do it. And by the time both of them stuck their teeth in the fruit, God was probably eating. Because they did something that kind of destroyed this relationship that they had with Him. I mean, it says in the Holy Scriptures, God will come down in the cool of the day. I mean, God will hang out with them. Cool of the day, talk to Adam and Eve. Somehow they kind of believe that what the plans of the serpent, they were much better, much more exciting. And instead of finding themselves ruling and reigning, they found themselves as slaves of Him. Do you understand what I'm saying? It broke God's heart. He didn't want them to do that. It was not His will for them to do that. But He will allow us to do those things if we really want to. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay? Because He wants us to make the right decisions. He wants us to mature as children. Let's see what's going on here. Not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living, wasteful living. He wanted to go as far away from the father as possible. He didn't want the father's world. He didn't want his values. He didn't want his principles. You're too corny. You're too traditional. You're too conservative. You're so sin aunda. I want something more exciting. I want to live as far away from you as possible. You've given me 10 commandments not to break. I want to be able to live in a world where I can break them and not feel guilty that I'm breaking them. Where everyone thinks like I do. Where everyone does things like I do. And we're okay with one another. You understand what I'm saying? We'll see that one today. Okay? There are some people who believe the LGBT is okay. And you still want to go to heaven. There are some people who believe that abortion is okay. And even now, even in the U.S., they allow that a baby that is born. And if you find that there's a deformity or a defect, you can kill it. Do you understand what I'm saying? And there are people who want that kind of a world without getting guilty about this. They're trying to pass a law that if you quote the Bible, if you tell them what God says about homosexuality or LGBT or abortion, they would consider it hate speech. And just because you dare to tell them what God said, you could be sent to jail. That's the kind of world that they're forming. You understand what I'm saying? This guy wanted nothing to do with his dad, with his values, with his principles, with his desire to help others. He said, well, you know, you want to help others? Go ahead, me, I'm helping myself. In your world, other people always come first. In my world, I'm always number one. Okay? But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Have you ever heard the song, I Did It My Way? What's the first dance that? And now the end is near. That's the first line. Now the end is near. Because it didn't work your way. You understand what I'm saying? Every time you try to live away from God, God is the source of your life. Understand this. You were not designed to live away from God. You were designed to live together with Him. You were created in the image of God, not in the image of the world. To try to live out somebody else's image in you, it's not really going to work. You can try to make it work, but it's not going to give you the satisfaction, the joy, the freedom that only God can give you. And so it says here, he spent everything, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. Okay? He figured, well, you know what? I've spent all my money, I've treated this guy, I've blessed them, I've helped their jobs, I've helped their economy. I'm sure they're going to get me. So he joined himself to a citizen of that country. He sent him into the fields to feed swine. So this is the kind of God that he gets in this kind of world. In the world where everyone is number one, well, if you're no longer rich, if you're no longer famous, if you're no longer helpful, if you're no longer not being wealthy, sorry. Okay? For as long as you have influence, as long as you have money, as long as you've got friends, I'd like to get to know, as long as you've got a position of authority that I could benefit from, I use you, you use me. Let's just use each other and manipulate each other. But the moment you lose that, sorry. So he probably thought he'd help again get a good position, but instead he was sent to feed swine. And in the mind of the Jews, this was the lowest job. Because for them, pigs were unclean. Do you understand what I'm saying? He was once royalty in the house of his father. He had authority, he had dignity, he had status in the house of his dad. Now here he was, reduced to a slave. And he said here, okay, it says here, and he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine eats, because no one gave him anything. He wanted to live in a world which was the exact opposite of the Father. If the Father was compassionate, this world was selfish. If his Father was generous, this world was not. If his Father was loving, this world was not. He chose to live in this world. In his father's house, people would have given him things. In the world he chose, he found out too late. Nobody was giving him anything. Not even a break. Are you getting this? Okay? Outside of the Father's love. there's only going to be heartbreak and misery. Not come out, but it will eventually come. Okay? So what happens now? Well, let's go to the second point. When we realize our mistake, go back. Receptive. When he came to himself. When he came to himself. Why? Was he away from himself? He was thinking of himself. This is just a figure of speech. It's something he realized was going on. Okay? Something he realized, why am I going through this? In my dad's house. Even my servants, our servants eat better than this. And here I am, I'm competing with pigs for their food. My servants eat better than this. Then what am I doing? He realizes himself. When he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare? And here I perish with hunger. He realizes his mistake. He threw away his heritage. He disgraced his father. He was probably thinking he must have probably written me off as dead. If his friends would ask him, what about your second son? Oh, he's dead. He's dead to me now. Verse 18 to 19, he says, I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Was he correct?
Yes.
He was. He was. Okay? I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me like one of your hired servants. Okay, I'm not even asking to be accepted back into the family. I'm begging you, Father, just hire me as one of the servants. I'm not even looking forward to being restored as part of that. So the slight was in his mind, and he arose and he came to his father. Now look at this. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him. How could his father have seen him if he had a very busy household? I mean, he had a household that needed a lot of maintenance because he had a lot of servants. Do you understand what I'm saying? How could his father have seen him when he was still afar off? They had no telescopes at that time, but believe me, they had high towers. And probably his father would stand, every time he's not busy, he would go into the high tower and he would look out the window, looking, is my son coming home? Could this be the day? 1 year passes, 2 years pass, 3 years, and he's still there, looking, watching, waiting. Could be this the day that he would come back? He never gave up hope on his son. This is your father. He never gives up on you. Even when you are at your lowest point, and your friends have given up on you, and your family have given up on you, there's one who will never, ever give up. Your father. This is your father's heart. It's being shown to us right now. This is Jesus giving us a glimpse of the father's heart. He never gives up on us. You understand what I'm saying? He saw him afar off. He could have only done that if he was awake. And he had to be a high point so he could look at all the areas around him. His father saw him. And what does it say here? But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. They know the reaction of the father was not disgust. Here comes a grateful son. How dare he show his face? How let me see. He was wearing rags. He left here, the finest robe. He was wearing rags. He was dirty. You probably see that. And he said, oh, it serves him right for leaving me. That's not what he felt. Compassion. You see, when we live our ways and we suffer because of our own foolishness, the Father does not look in heaven. He has compassion. And this is the heart of the Father being revealed. And he says here, his Father saw him and had compassion and ran. He didn't wait for him to come to the house. He didn't say, well, let him just come in. And when he comes to the door, I'll tell the servants, if he wants to enter this house, he asks whether on both hands and knees and beg for me to have mercy. That's not how he reacted. He couldn't wait for his son who disgraced him. His son who shamed him. His son who almost disowned him. Couldn't care less whether he was alive or dead. And this is how he felt. Compassion. And he didn't wait for him to come to the house. The father left his house and ran towards his dirty son and fell on him. Think about this. The father was well groomed. He was probably bathed and he had come. He smelled good. The son could not smell good if he was speaking with pigs. And you're traveling on the road and you're sleeping by the forests. It could not have been easy for him to come back. They didn't have the kind of transportation they have today. It's probably dirty, muddy, smell by pigs, and mud, and dirt. The father saw him, embraced him, kissed him. You understand what I'm saying? This is our father. His son. The moment he sees us coming back to him, he doesn't make us feel how badly we treated him, but rather he welcomes us back. The moment we recognize our mistake and we repent, the Father jumps to meet us. You understand what I'm saying? I heard something before. I said, if you have walked 100,000 steps away from God, you decide to return to him, all you need is one step. Because the Father will jump 999 steps to meet you. You understand what I'm saying? This is our Father. He would rather show mercy than judgment. And mercy is shown especially when we repent. And so the Son goes into speech. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. His next sentence would be, just accept me as one of your hired servants. But his father did not even give him a chance to say that. What did the father do? Okay? And, you know, we're already in the middle. The father said to his servants, bring out the best robe. Okay? The robe symbolized the dignity of a son. You understand what I'm saying? He said, I'm no longer worthy to become your son. I disgrace you, I shame you. I threw away this life that you have so graciously, generously, mercifully given to me, and I don't deserve it anymore. Just make this one of your hired servants, and the father didn't even give him a chance to say that. And said to her, give him one of the best words. The robes belong only to the royal members of that family. When you wear the robe, you have the dignity of a member of that royal family. Okay? What else? Says here, put it on him, put a ring on his hand. The ring signifies authority. When I was installed as a bishop's ring was given to me. It signified authority. Some of you kiss the ring. What are you saying? You're saying, I am submitted to the authority that was given to you. Because the authority came from Christ. You understand what I'm saying? He said, I'm no longer worthy to have an authority myself. I can be served. Give him his ring. Give him the ring. Authority was restored back to him. Okay? And then it says here, and put some sandals on his feet. In that house, only servants walk barefoot. That's how that's happening. He's saying, I am restoring his status to him. He is a son with the dignity of a son and with the authority of a son. You understand that? Amen? This is how our Father feels towards us. And that when we sin, don't take long coming back to him. He's not a God who blows over us and makes him lower than what we already feel. People do that, but God doesn't. Okay? There's a guy who wrote a song, Reckless Love. Came out this year, I think. Or last year, not sure. And it became a controversy. God's not reckless. See, when you talk about reckless, that means you're not considering the possible risk of my papers. Well, no, God doesn't take any risk. Because he's God. But to us, it seems like it's reckless. God, how sure are you still going to do it again? Don't we want guarantees? Right? Somebody does us wrong, and we want to forgive it and restore everything. We even have a guarantee that he's not going to do it again. What is the guarantee that the father had that his son would not waste this second opportunity? Well, no guarantees given. It's just not. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay? Do you see him giving off a lot? Okay, I'm giving you a hope, I'm giving you a ring, I'm giving you a son, but if you ever do it again, that's it. People do that, God doesn't. You understand what I'm saying? And he's not being reckless. Now, can't read the story of the second son, but the other son. There was a party, he had a fat calf killed, missed his son. He came back on the field, he's never left his father. And there was a party, he says, what's going on? So he asked one servant, what's the party? It's the occasion. I'm your brother, he came back. Well, he got back. And when he confronted his father, he didn't want to join the party. The father said, what's the matter, son? I worked for you all these years. I never left you. Never even gave me a fat calf. That this other son of yours, he couldn't even say my brother. This son of yours takes away what you've given, wasted. He thought, and you had fat calf killed for him? I mean, it's okay for you for him to be wasteful? That kind of living is okay for you? That's how you say it. And he said, no. We're celebrating this because he was living as if he was dead. Outside of the Father, it's a dead life. It's a zombie kind of a life. Okay? But he's back. He's with us again. He's alive again. And that's the reason why we're celebrating. Don't be mad. Why? Are you angry at me that I didn't give you a fat calf? You were with me. And what I had is yours. You could have had a fat calf at any time. Don't be scandalized because of what I'm doing for your brother. Don't feel bad. Just be grateful he's back. You understand what I'm saying? Remember, I saw this guy. When he was small, his mother was praying for him, and one of the prayers of the mother, Lord, make him a man. minister in the church. But he grew up, it was a hard life. He became a slave trader. He was also called the Greek blasphemer, which means when he cursed, he could really curse out a storm. And he would kidnap people, sell people. And he was so bad, even his own crew got angry at him, that when they got into a particular island where they would get slaves, they sold him to the chief of the tribe where they got slaves. So eventually, this same traitor became a slave to a tribe of slaves. And somehow he was so bad. Somehow he escaped. And he was engaged in this kind of lifestyle until one day there was a shipwreck in the sea and he was about to die. And something he remembered about was about God. He started thinking about this God. Still did not change his lifestyle. But he was now thinking about this God. One day he decided, Lord, I can't live this way anymore. He started to hate what he was doing. Enslaving people. He wanted to set people free. And so he started studying the Holy Scriptures. He started preaching to them. Eventually he became a minister again. And when he thought, while he was doing this, he thought about the grace of God in his life. Who am I that God would do this for me? I mean, I was so bad, I blasphemed God, I did this to people. And here I am, I'm a minister in his church. How could God use me like this? And one who was thinking about the grace of God, the words came to him, and he wrote, Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now his name was John Newton. He wrote about grace because he experienced the unlimited grace and the unconditional love of God. Something we also have. Amen. I think you learned something today. Praise God, it's all set.
Thus God prepares the apostles. Altogether, I believe in God, the Father of life, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead, the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again, and judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
With faith in his eternal word, let us pray.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That you may all be one.
God, that every member of the church may know yet come to serve.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for a great prayer, pray please. From private heart of us, and all who chefs of peace, deacons, and other ministers.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
Pray for all of your word and all the
that there be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will that we undertake.
Our words may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from envy or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Praise for your saints and entered into joy.
May we also welcome to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Pray for this in the Cathedral Church of St. Pius.
In your faithfulness, hear us, O Lord.
O Lord our God, send the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls. And to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Therefore, the peace of God be always with you.
And with you with your spirit.
Let us now share the peace of Christ with our family.
say you can be without love care, but you cannot love care without giving. So giving is one way to express our love care about things about us. We stand, we recite the Republic proclamation. Together, our many dance lost in confusion and return to the world for help. At first, just two, but to begin, almost one. The Lord is truly, and he wanted us from us. We have cried to the Lord our God, and heard us. Without us, safely, the world system. He brought us into a new kingdom, sealed with abundance. And our ministry, bring our family, bring with us this salvation, and I will worship the Lord for his mercy. We shall rejoice in the leaders of the church, living as saviors, in all the good which the Lord our God has given us. May the tithe and give our hearts to the living of God. I will say to the Lord our God, I move my house, all the holy and sacred portion, giving them to the leaders in obedience to our arms. I have not consumed the portions and sadness that is obedient, but given it to the dead. Look down on us, and blessed be you, and the flow of your prayers. This is your faith in love.
You were dead. I Oh.
when we have fallen into sin and become subject to evil again, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms on the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. And so, Father, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit might descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts to your holy people, the bread of life, the cup of salvation, the body and the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. On the night we send it over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ, the bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins whenever you drink. Do this for the remembrance of me." Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ truly died for you, even if your hearts by faith, always with thanksgiving. You're grateful to the Lord our God how that He has given us so much. He is a great God, and He has prepared everything for us. Because of what Jesus Christ did, God is our Father. Jesus, not just our Savior, Redeemer, and Lord, He's also our brother. And the Holy Spirit, He's our mentor, our guide, our father, a friend who speaks closer than a brother. That's the Holy Spirit. And we have the sacraments. We have the angels of God. We have the entire resources of heaven because of His love for us. This is the body of Christ and brethren, my Lord, my God. The love of us and God of salvation. Praise God once again to come before the table of the Lord. We know that Jesus Christ said to us, my flesh is food indeed. My blood is drink indeed. It's not just something sentimental. It's not just something symbolic. It's not just something that's good to think about. It's something very real, very powerful, very profound takes place. For us to be partaking, we receive often. And the more we receive often, it helps us to be more and more alike. And Jesus Christ said, whenever you do this, you proclaim my death. Well, St. Paul said, I believe that's what Jesus Christ said to St. Paul. Why do we proclaim the death of the Lord? Because this is the price that Jesus paid so that you and I today might have the life of God in us. Our life, the life we have now, is not a recycled kind of life. It's a brand new life. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away. All things have become new. It is the life of God that He has given unto us. And so with joy, with gladness, with humility, come let the feast begin. Thank you. Praise God once again as we receive blessing from God Almighty, together with grateful hearts, let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and for assuring us of these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. Now, Father, set us out to do the work you've given us to do, to let us serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ, our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, ruler of the heavenly hosts, send forth Saint Michael, the archangel, to defend us in the day of battle. Let him be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil, whom we rebuke by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we humbly pray to thee, Saint Michael, as the prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, pass into hell, Satan, and all other evil spirits who roam the world, seeking the ruin of souls, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Look down in mercy, Lord, on your people who kneel before you, and grant to those who have what you have nourished by your word and sacraments, may bring forth fruit worthy of your repentance, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Be stand.
Oh, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. In the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.